manner.
Have you subscribed to Manor Post? Receive the latest news and updates when Manor Entertainment's weekly newsletter is delivered to your email every Saturday. A subscription is free and takes less than 30 seconds to sign up. Go to manorhq.com and fill out the form on the homepage. Join the rapid growing list of Manor Post subscribers by requesting your weekly delivery today. Sign up at manorhq.com. That's manorhq.com. Visit Manor Entertainment's official website and social media. Our official website is manorhq.com. Follow us on Twitter at Official Manor. We're on Instagram at Manor Entertainment. And our YouTube channel is listed under Manor Entertainment, where you'll find many of our features currently playing. Again, visit our website, manorhq.com. Follow us on Twitter at Official Manor. Follow us on Instagram at Manor Entertainment. And subscribe to our YouTube channel listed under Manor Entertainment. As always, share with others and spread the word.
Warning: the following program may contain violence, explicit language, sexual situations, and dark content, unsuitable for some listeners. It is intended for mature audiences only. Discretion is advised.
The 5-year-old boy peered around the corner where his father was watching a movie. And in that most singular moment on the glowing screen in that dark room, hands reached out and choked a beautiful woman's throat. The woman woke. It was all a dream. But the boy kept watching. And just a few moments later, the beautiful woman was in her bathrobe in the kitchen, just when a knife flew off the wall, flipped through the air, and stuck in the floor right at her feet. Then a ketchup bottle overturned, pouring red stuff all around the stuck blade.
Yeah.
The special effects weren't great. The boy, myself, at an age of relative innocence and optimism, even knew this. But something about the abruptness, the utter insanity of what I was seeing meant I could not look away. Even though I was not technically allowed to watch most of the distinctly R-rated movies my father watched from his well-worn groove in the yellowing couch, I still found ways to watch virtually all the awesome grown-up selections from the mid-1980s, both the Arnold Schwarzenegger features and the non-Arnold Schwarzenegger features. So which board was my viewing that one fateful night in 1987? It was the tale of a Ouija board brought to a party to contact a young boy like myself, but who drowned years earlier. However, the board is left behind with the impressionable young host, who gradually becomes a victim of progressive entrapment, a kind of possession from using the Ouija board too much. You see, starlet Tawny Kitaen and her two suitors assumed the spirit they were talking to was of a drowned little boy, but instead it was a legendary Portuguese serial killer named Malfeitor who killed and died in that very same house. The conclusion of the movie 90 minutes later kicked off a period still known in my family as the time Seth watched that movie. I did not sleep for a month. I was convinced there was a witch outside my window I could not see, which tapped on the storm window when it rained. My parents continually assured me there was no such thing. But when they left my darkened room, the squeaky and loose bolted bed trembled with the very pounding of my heart, and my panic only grew. Eventually, I slept with the little banker's light on, the strange green and white light at least assuring me things weren't flying off the walls at me from the dark. Around that time, I was a pretty happy-go-lucky kid, and while there was some family turmoil, life was mostly good in my suburban New Jersey household. My brother, much older than I, went away to college that year, just down the road at Rutgers University. I was kind of a rambunctious child, and my father once told my mother to ask the pediatrician what was wrong with him at my regular checkup. Despite my energy, I sat silent in church each Sunday. The sermons proselytizing about the love of Jesus weren't that interesting, to be honest. But the book of Revelation sure was. I think maybe that's why I was grappling with some of the great beyond at the time of filmmaker Kevin Tenney's overlooked masterpiece. How could all the people who ever died on the earth rise all at once on Judgment Day? Where do Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny and the Tooth Fairy go when the apocalypse is nigh? Do they ride at the right hand of angry, judgmental Jesus? These questions and many others wheeled through my mind. Plus, my dad's dad had died in 1985, a formative memory of mine. And both of my grandmothers were long gone since the 1960s. So I had a flirting acquaintance with death and finality. The fact of the end being so close and yet so far, and so inexplicable to a fledgling person, meant I was fascinated by whether the end really was the end. Along came Witchboard, tear-assing through space and time and screen, plunging right into my overheated little brain. Because the end was thus never the end, at least when it came to Portuguese serial killers. Maybe not grandmas, but why was it Witchboard that warped me, and not any of the other horror movies I have since come to love from 1986? That year alone saw Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, Little Shop of Horrors, Aliens, Chopping Mall, Slaughter High, and others which I have come to adore in subsequent years. I suspect my father, not a horror fan at all, was watching it for potential nude scenes of Tawny Katayan, the model from the White Snake music videos of previous years. My mother, who was and is a huge horror fanatic, was in the kitchen down the hall, probably watching Cheers or Night Court. So it was a weird, bizarro night. The movie itself is a bizarro little flick. Most do indeed remember it from the Tawny Katayan shower scene, right toward the end of the movie. It was a scene that had to be filmed with a bare minimum of crew on the set due to the surprising bashfulness of the model who was then dating O.J. Simpson at the time of the filming, according to Progressive Entrapment, The Making of Witchboard. But years later, after I was already a teenage Hooper and Romero freak, I revisited the VHS from our local rental place, Video, and I was still shocked at the part where Malfader swings his axe and lobs off poor Tawny's head in one nightmarish stroke. Very visage of J.P. Lubson, the kindly photographer who played Malfader, still gave me fits as a teenager, and still does to this day, even when he's smiling during an interview decades after the filming of a little horror movie that didn't do so well at the box office. Indeed, that sleepless month caused by Witchboard in 1987 made me immune to almost all horror movies. It was a terror inoculation of sorts. But Witchboard still gives me the willies. It was imprinted on my DNA in 1987, I believe. I wonder what it will do for my daughter. She's 3 now. I may wait for her to see it, at least until age 7 or so. Probably because that's the same age my brother had his own horror experience, referred to in family lore as the time your mother took David to see Burnt Offerings in the theater. Because that's what happened in 1976. And at the tender age of 7, he was thoroughly traumatized, perhaps foremost by the scene where Oliver Reed tries to drown his young son in a swimming pool during a violent possession. But enough about this brand of family trauma by film. The reason I bring all this up, to illustrate what makes horror fans and then writers of some of us, my brother took one glance at a fully possessed Karen Black in the attic of the summer rental home at the climax of the excellent Burnt Offerings and swore off horror forever. He has since stayed away from anything scarier than the movie Roadhouse. But I was different. You see, there is something in my programming which meant I had to take a look around that corner. And some invisible hand had to pin me there to see what happens next. I think that hand was my own hand, my own agency. I needed to see. And after those first weeks of sleeplessness were put aside, I needed to see more. And after that, I needed to create my own visions to keep someone else up at night. Or at least lure the guileless around that proverbial corner.
The Horror Complex, Episode 2, Witchboards, Burnt Offerings, and Why Some Crave the Dark. Subscribe to this show and leave a rating, a review, and general feedback wherever you're receiving this program. Share with others on social media and elsewhere. Your feedback, as well as sharing with others, helps future productions. Credits: written and narrated by Seth Augenstein. Directed, produced, edited, and scripted by Rock Capuano. Audio and sound design by Edel SFX. Audio excerpts from the film Witchboard, 1986. Music by Kogue. Theme song by Alan Postscript. Cover art by Enzo Schiatti. The Horror Complex was created by Rock Capuano. The Horror Complex is a Manor Entertainment production. This production is property of Manor Entertainment, LLC. No portion of this production may be reproduced or used by any means without the proper written consent of Manor Entertainment, LLC. This production is protected under the copyright laws of the United States and other countries throughout the world. Any unauthorized exhibition, distribution, or copying of this production or any part thereof may result in civil liability and criminal prosecution. Copyright 2019, Manor Entertainment, LLC. Manor.